Hello, and welcome back to another video with It's Dr. Dan. And what we are doing today is finding the empirical and molecular formula from percent compositions. Now, if you are not familiar with a mass percent composition, please refer to my previous video on that, so that way you can make sure you understand how to use percents. Now, before we get into it, though, really is let's try to go into really what is the difference between these two things, because honestly, whenever I saw these as a general chemistry student, it was extremely overwhelming and extremely confusing to try to be able to figure out what the difference is between these two general definitions. So let's take a look at it, try to decipher it, so that way you're able to understand it and to solve these in your introductory or your general chemistry course. Okay, so the whole idea with this is really, well, what is it? Well, the first thing is that word empirical formula, which is the simplest whole number ratio of every atom that's found within a molecular formula. And when you read that, you're like, what? There's so many science terms that are being used. Let's try to break it down. So the first thing is, let's say if I have the following species here. So I have a butane here, so the same thing that you have in lighters. And what we're going to do is we're going to count how many elements there are with inside the species, meaning we're going to count the number of carbons and the number of hydrogens that are all around it. So the first thing you got to do is you got to identify what each element is. So we see we have a C and then we have an H. Now what we're going to do is we're going to count all these little pieces, because what the molecular formula represents is what the actual composition is of this molecule. So this is the regular formula. So it's what you're going to see in a chemical reaction, what's actually going to be doing the science here. So when we are looking at that, we're going to do is count all these little orange carbons here, and we can see we have four of them. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4. So it's going to be C4. Now what we're going to do is we're going to count all the hydrogens that are around this, and we can see we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And let's put some numbers around them just so that way we can see where are all those numbers coming from, right? So we have all these little hydrogens. So it's going to be C4H10. Now, with the definition of empirical formula that I mentioned before, this is the simplest whole number ratio of every atom. Meaning, what can we divide all those numbers by, the C4H10, to get a simpler ratio? So what are those values? Well, if we can kind of think of it, we have 4 and 10. So what can you divide both those numbers to simplify it? Well, generally, the numbers that you want to think of are things like 2, 3, 4, 5, those small numbers that usually you divide things by to simplify. So let's pick the first one, which is 2. So if I divide both these numbers by 2, what are you going to get? Well, you're going to get 2, and then you're going to get 5 for the other one. Now, could you divide it by another number? Well, if you kind of think about it, well, 3 and 4 are not divisible, because this has to be the smallest whole number ratio. So by dividing these by 2, what we end up getting is C2H5, which this is the empirical formula for this compound. Now, the reason for why empirical formulas are so important has for multiple reasons. One of them has to do with ionic compounds, which we only find in formula units when you are trying to figure out exactly how does charges try to cancel out and how do they exist. The other way is, well, when you're in the lab, the only thing you can do is measure a sample, which is a specific percentage of each individual element. So you got to be able to decipher what all those things means, okay? So this is the idea. Let's try another one. H, N, and O, which all have their own different colors. So let's first count all the carbons, which are the ones in orange and yellow. So when we do that, we can see that, okay, well, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Right, all around our compound. Now we're going to count all the hydrogens that we have, and we can see that, well, we have a lot of them. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and 12. Okay, so we have C10, H12 so far. Oh, that's a lot of numbers. Luckily, we only have two blue ones, which are two nitrogens, and we only have one oxygen within this molecule. Now, what we're going to do is, are these different values, are they divisible by a simple whole number? So what did we have? We had 10, 12, 2, and 1. Well, one thing you're going to notice is, oh, wait, we have a 1 here. Can we divide that by 2? Well, you can't have a half of an element, right? So what this tells us is that the molecular formula and the empirical formula are the same thing. So it does not always have to be something completely different. They can be the exact same value, okay? So it's always about what's the simplest whole number ratio. So keep that in mind. They don't always have to be something different. It could be a trick question sometimes, right? Us professors love to throw trick questions at our students. Let's try to look at how we can actually utilize this in a mathematical way. Right, so the most common way that you're going to be seeing empirical formulas is always through mathematics. Chemistry is secretly a math class in disguise. Your professors will never admit it to you, but it is. It's a big math class. So let's take a look at this so that way we can understand and interpret data, which you could potentially get in the laboratory setting. So caffeine has the following mass percent composition, right? Caffeine is what keeps us all going every single day. What is the empirical formula? And if the molar mass is 194.19 grams per mole, what is the molecular formula? Oh boy. So from these types of problems, commonly you will get a set of percents, which tell you how much of each individual element exists. Let's go through this type of problem step by step so that way you can break it down for any homework question or for any type of exam style problem. Let's take a look at it. All right, the first step, the how-to guide, how to solve for an empirical formula problem, because I can guarantee you will probably see one on your first exam or your second exam in a general chemistry course. So the first thing you need to do is assume that you have a 100 gram sample, which allows you to convert the percents into actual usable numbers. So we need to convert the percents for step one. And this is actually a very easy step. So that's the good news. So what you're going to do is, if you look at carbon, for example, it says we have 49.98%. So if we assume that this is out of 100 grams, we can simply just write 49.98 grams of our sample is carbon here, right? So we can just write that assumption down. Now, for the next one, we can do the same thing for hydrogen. We can say we have 5.19 grams of hydrogen. We can say that we have nitrogen is 28.85 grams of nitrogen. And then oxygen, we can say that we have 16.48 grams of oxygen. And when you add up all these values together, it's essentially telling you, like, oh, within this whole caffeine sample, we have this amount of each element here that exists. Now, what exactly are we going to do with that? Well, in step two, we're going to take these values and we're going to convert them to moles, okay? So the goal is always the mole when it comes to chemistry. You need to try to convert things to moles. So the goal is the mole. So what we're going to do is we're going to take each of those values that we had above and convert them to moles. So the very first one was at 49.98 grams of carbon all the way at the top. So we will take 49.98 grams of carbon and convert it using our molar masses. So we have them already available right here on the screen from the periodic table. And we are going to convert them using a little step conversion that we've used before in our mole videos. Right, so we cancel our units using that molar mass, and what we are going to end up getting for our first one is 4.16 moles of carbon. Now we're going to do this for each individual species. So let's do the next one, which was hydrogen, and what we had for that value was 5.19 grams. So let's put that down here at the bottom. But let's just copy them all down. So nitrogen was 28.85 grams. And then oxygen was 16.48. Okay. Now, when we go through this conversion, so we'll set up our little T tables for ourselves. We have the 1.008 grams for every 1 mole of hydrogen. And what we are going to end up getting when we do this conversion is 5.15 moles of hydrogen. For the next one, we are taking that 28.85 grams of nitrogen, converting that as well, using our periodic table values, right, which was 14.01 grams of nitrogen. And that is going to be equivalent to 1 mole of nitrogen. When we get that value, we are going to have 2.05 moles of nitrogen. And then we'll once again convert the last value to moles, which is 15.99 grams of oxygen for every 1 mole of oxygen. And that's going to be equivalent to 1.03 moles of oxygen. Now, why did we convert all of these different values that are here? We have so many of them available. Now, if you can think back to what does it mean when you're counting subscripts? Well, a subscript represents the number of moles within a chemical species. However, all these have decimals. So how do you simplify them to the lowest whole number ratio? What the next step is going to be is you're going to divide each mole value by the lowest number that we calculated, because these have to be whole number values. So let's recopy these for ourselves so we can see which one is the lowest value. So we have carbon, we have hydrogen, we have nitrogen, we have oxygen. So let's put all these down. So we have 1.05, 2.05, 5.15, and 4.16. Now, with all those values, which one of these is the smallest? Well, you can quickly see oxygen is your tiniest value. So what we're going to do is we're going to divide all of these values by 1.03. Now, when you do this, it's going to lead to a whole number value, which represents the subscript of your empirical formula. So when we do this for oxygen, you're going to have 1. For nitrogen, you're going to have 2. For hydrogen, it's going to be 5. And for carbon, you're going to have 4. So when you take these values, your empirical formula is going to be C4H5N2O. And that is how to calculate your empirical formula. Now, the thing with this, though, we're not done yet, which I've extended this problem to a longer type of problem, which is what if you need to calculate what the molecular formula is as well? Because remember, this is just the simplest whole number value, right? So empirical. So we have our empirical formula, which is the simplest ratio. So it's not the same thing as the molecular formula. So let's go on to our next step. So the next step, which is optional, depends on the type of problem you have. So what you need to do is divide the molar mass of the molecule by the empirical mass. And what that allows you to do is it gives you a ratio, which that ratio is what you're going to multiply the empirical formula by. So let's calculate first. So we already have the molecular mass that was given to us in the problem. So that's going to get plugged in right here into our formula. What is the empirical mass? So we got to take these values and calculate it. So let's do that. So what we have, right, we have 4 carbon atoms. And we are going to multiply that by 12.01, add that by 5 hydrogens, times that by 1.008. And as always, we want to make sure we put all these in parentheses for ourselves. Plus nitrogen, right? We have 2 nitrogens, 14.01, plus 1 oxygen. Now, when we add up all of these values, these are going to be in grams per mole of your empirical formula, which is going to be 97.09 grams per mole of your empirical formula. And what we're going to do with that value is that's going to then get plugged in to this equation above as well. So let's take those two values and divide them. So we'll have 194.19 grams per mole divided by 97.09 grams per mole, and we will get a ratio of 2. Now, what does that tell us? So the last step is using the ratio. So what we need to do is take the ratio and times that by the empirical formula, which from before was C4H5N2O. And by doing that, it's going to give you what the actual molecular formula is, which is C8H10N4O2, which is what keeps us going every single day. This is the formula of caffeine, the molecular formula. So that's the true identity of it versus the empirical formula, which is the most simplified version. I hope that this video helped you by going through the steps and listing them out on how to do it. I recommend trying to practice these kinds of problems for yourselves, because I really have never seen a general chemistry or an introductory chemistry teacher does not give this kind of problem on an exam. Practice it. I hope this helped. And please hit that like and subscribe button. I hope to see you around for future videos. I'll see you all later now. Bye now.